Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Founder by Alexey Osadchuk. Translated by Irene Woodhead and Neil P. Woodhead. Narrated by Jonathan Sleep. Chapter 1. In due time, my offline vacation had run its course. The near-month stint in occupational therapy had flashed past like a single day. Now I was riding a coach with several fellow gamers heading for the airport. Our return flight was due in 3 hours' time. We were going back. Time to get back to work. Berlin bid us a chilly farewell, laced with cold rain, grim heavy clouds, and a bitter wind. I stared through the coach window, watching trees and houses flash past, pedestrians trotting at the double to escape the elements. "What a weather," I muttered to myself. The guy next to me chuckled.
"You could say that."
He winced, clearly nursing a hangover. Judging by his state, he must have spent the last few days checking out Berlin's watering holes. From what I already knew, his game moniker was apparently Kraken.
"Oh no, not that douchebag again," exclaimed somebody at the front.
I cast a lazy glance at the sequence of colorful posters lining the motorway. Of course, the biggest one depicted a happily grinning Romulus hugging a beer mug. Yes, you heard it right. Romulus from the Steel Shirts clan, as large as life, now the number one player in Mirror World. Within the last few months, our planet as we'd known it had undergone some very curious developments. The advertising business had found a new, very trendy niche, namely glasshouse players. Not the actual real-world people, but rather their in-game avatars. Athletes and Hollywood stars had been obliged to move over, making room for these new celebrities, as Mirror World's top players were now at the peak of their popularity. The Reflex Group Corporation continued to pour indecent amounts of money into promotion. Everywhere you turned, on t-shirts and coffee mugs, badges and baseball caps, all you could see were the faces of the game's top players clad in combat armor or riding awesome mounts. Even some of the most prominent fast food chains had jumped on this crazy bandwagon. I'll never forget how we'd discovered a tiny plastic figurine of one of the top 10 players stuck inside Krista's kid's meal. The girl was actually quite excited, saying that very soon we too might be available for sale. Myself, Pranky, and Boris, that is. At the time, we'd just laughed it off. Still, throughout that evening, I had kept catching my wife's pensive stare wandering over me. She was up to something, I could see that. Actually, wouldn't be surprised if she'd already divulged her plan to Rorgus. I'd walked in on them once, having a heated virtual conference, both their desks piled high with paperwork, calculators, and office paraphernalia. As I'd inquired of them the reasons for all this, I was reassured this was only a work in progress whose purpose was to make us all stinking rich, and which would soon be presented for my consideration and approval. They also added that I shouldn't be distracting myself with such petty things, but focused on my main task instead, namely becoming the toughest cookie in the whole of Glasshouse and trying to hoard as much nice, juicy loot as was humanly possible. We'd had a good laugh, but I'd made sure I'd warned them not to do anything without running it past me first. The two saluted me in sync, then picked up their discussion from where they'd left it.
"They're just jealous."
Kraken's voice pulled me out of my musings.
"Greedy bastards."
He nodded at the indignant players in the front, still fuming over Romulus's luck.
"They'd be over the moon if the corporation offered them an advertising contract. Personally, I'd be over the moon. With that kind of money, you're fixed for life, man. Only who would want us with our mediocre levels and pathetic rankings? You need to make the top 500 at least, or have charisma and buckets like that dude with his flying mount."
His last phrase came as a complete surprise to me. It took all of my self-control to keep the poker face and mumble my agreement.
"My point entirely."
The guy behind us butted in, sticking his narrow, thickly freckled face through the gap between our seat backs. From what I remembered, his game name was Cougar.
I'm sick and tired of all those soccer players and movie stars peddling stuff on billboards and TV. Same old faces. It's about time gamers had their chance. At least it would add a bit of variety.
If you ask me, this is only the beginning,
Kraken said pointedly.
The glasshouse owners haven't even started yet. You give them some time. Like the other night, I went to check out Berlin's nightlife with the boys. We popped into this bar for a couple of beers.
Cougar and I couldn't help smirking.
They shoved the beer cart at us like they always do,
he continued, ignoring our sarcasm.
And what do you think? I started looking through the card and guess what?
You passed out from just seeing their prices?
Cougar offered with a guffaw.
Oh, do shut up.
Kraken waved the jibe away, then added, after a pause,
Actually, there was that to it too, but that's not what I'm talking about. Guess what I saw on the list? Dwarven Double Rainbow, Black Gnome, Alvin Wheat Ale. A good dozen of them in total, and that wasn't all. When I asked for the menu, I saw Roast Lamb Melonville Style, Papa Grudo's Green Pudding, etc., etc. Know what I mean?
Cougar shrugged.
What's there to know? These days, every restaurant worth their salt serves glasshouse food, which tastes exactly how it does in the game. It had to be expected. They haven't even started yet. I've just read they're about to start filming a series set in Mirror World.
They went on talking, discussing all sorts of new stuff introduced by the corporation. Beer, t-shirts, toys, TV series. And still, I had a funny feeling we could only see the tip of the iceberg. The rest of it was a giant chunk of ice lurking deep below. Still, what we could see was already a lot. Apart from all sorts of advertising junk, Reflex Group owned at least one airline, a chain of filling stations, and well over a dozen clinics and research labs. Ironically, the clinic that had performed the heart surgery on my daughter Krista also turned out to be one of their own, and so was the occupational therapy center where my brother had transferred me to, as was the Japanese lab where they'd grown a new heart for my daughter. Once I'd spent some quality time on the internet, I discovered that the glasshouse owners actively invested in cutting-edge medicine and pharmaceuticals. Everywhere you turned, the evidence of their presence was there, from space programs to IT technologies to alternative energy. Actually, the VR pod I'd been using recently was infinitely more advanced than those installed in communal module centers. Even though my extended immersion experience had reduced me to a rather vegetative state, after the initial few days IRL, I'd begun to recuperate remarkably quickly. What's more, despite all that time spent lying belly up inside the pod, I was actually fitter now than I'd been before the immersion. Even my eyesight had improved. And that wasn't all. Now that my Krista had had her heart transplant, her health was improving in leaps and bounds, all thanks to the newest medications courtesy of Samura Pharmaceuticals, which, incidentally, also belonged to Reflex Group. All of this prompted a logical question. What was the actual purpose of them creating Mirror World? Was it a game, or could it be the testing grounds for some revolutionary new technologies? Because if the latter was true, I dreaded to even contemplate the mental state of the first volunteers who dared lay in the very first prototype VR pods. Because there must have been some volunteer beta testers involved, right? Incidentally, my internet search had produced no mention of them. So whenever people started discussing glasshouse beer and the company's aggressive promotion tactics, I just smiled. All this hoo-ha around the top players in their rankings was just a bright candy wrapper. I didn't bother to reply to Kraken's new diatribe, just nodded my agreement with a demonstrative yawn, as in, you guys just keep talking and let a guy catch a few Z's. Seeing me close my eyes, the two men toned down their voices while carrying on their discussion. If the truth were known, this wasn't the right moment for me to start wondering about a mega corporation's ways of best investing its multi-billion gains. All else aside, it was thanks to their activities that my daughter was alive now. It was true that their services came with a hefty price tag attached, but personally, no costs were too exorbitant provided my girl could live. Thoughts of my family brought a smile to my lips as I remembered a recent conversation I'd had with my wife. "They ain't gonna leave us alone," Sveta had said. A fine line ran across her forehead. Her lips were pursed, the corners of her mouth turned down. It had been almost a month since they'd set me free, and not a single day had passed without us discussing my future progress through the game in every detail. The thing that my wife was especially concerned about was the clans. The long hours spent perusing glasshouse forms had only fanned the flames of her clan phobia. The horrors she'd read. I'd skimmed one of their posts once, and had I come across this forum before creating a Mirror World account, I wouldn't have taken this game half so lightly to begin with. All this time, I'd been trying to convince Sveta to stop winding herself up by reading internet campfire tales. I thought she'd taken notice, but sometimes she just couldn't keep it all pent up, and this was one such moment. "It's okay, sweet," I said with a smile, giving her a hug. "Trust me, I have something to say to those who attempt to attack either me or the Red Owls. You shouldn't forget that your husband isn't some zero-level goner dude anymore." She heaved a heavy sigh, but didn't say anything. She was just worried about me. I was about to embark on a new immersion, and having a loved one worry about you is the most natural thing in the world. It was Krista who diffused the situation.
"Dad, do you think that Pranky and Boris are gonna grow some still?"
Sveta and I turned our heads in unison. Our girl was half lying on a couch where she'd been asleep for the last half hour, lulled into a slumber by some book she'd been reading. Her eyes were still sleepy, her face warm and rosy. Sveta and I exchanged glances. It had only been 2 months since she'd had her surgery, but she was a far cry from the sickly kid she'd once been. Her new Japanese heart had grafted just fine. The surgeon himself couldn't stop marveling at her body performance data. The girl was coming alive before our very eyes.
"Of course they will, sweetheart," I said, perching myself on the couch by her feet. "I think they're going to continue to grow with every new level gained."
Krista promptly climbed onto my lap and flung her arms around my neck.
"You remember what you promised, right?"
she whispered, her warm breath gently tickling my ear. I smiled.
"Of course. You read it yourself, didn't you? Very soon they'll be able to allow children to be immersed in Mirror World. On one condition."
She sighed.
"Oh, sure. I remember. They need a doctor's clearance."
"No offense, okay?"
"Okay,"
she agreed in a very grown-up way before changing the subject.
"Would I be able to see No Man's Lands too?"
I shook my head.
"I don't think so. We've only been talking about Melonville, but there's plenty of things for you to do there. Trust me."
Krista's bright blue eyes grew even bigger. A flush of pink touched her cheeks. As I admired the excitement on her face, it suddenly dawned on me that she would have been stunned to find out the extent of my unwillingness to go back into the game. Still, I was obliged to do so. That bank loan wasn't going to pay itself.
"Olgerd, wake up, man!"
Someone shook me by the shoulder. I opened my eyes, looking around short-sightedly. Kraken was already up and about, pulling his backpack down from the overhead storage rack, a cheerful smile playing on his face.
"I've never seen anyone that can sleep like you. Get up now. Great deeds await us."
"Hi there, pilot,"
a female master greeted me. This game and its nicknames. It had only taken the new moniker a few months to become an indelible part of me. No one at the forums seemed to remember my real name anymore. Not that I found it annoying, just a bit weird, if you know what I mean.
"Hi, ma'am," I replied.
This was the master that Rorgus had put me into contact with. She was a true blue no-mess if I'd ever seen one, her hands like two shovels, her eyes glaring grimly from under her frowning eyebrows. Her face was covered in a complex pattern of angular tattoo designs. I could read a hint of confusion in her stone-gray squint. She can't have expected this kind of reaction, that's for sure. Probably waiting for a jibe or a sarcastic sneer.
"You don't seem to be too surprised by my appearance, do you?"
she finally asked, confirming my suspicions. Her broad mouth spread into a cunning grin, bearing two rows of steel teeth. I shrugged.
"Should I be? I learned my lesson on my first day in the game when I met a certain young lady disguised as a 10-foot horrid. I just can't be bothered to be fazed by someone's choice of character anymore. The nomess guffawed.
Accepted.
She pushed open the two halves of a thick steel door and added,
Welcome to my lair, Sir Olgerd.
What she called a lair was in fact a big two-story stone house right at the center of Retal, a small town in the east of the Lands of Light. Local mobs were levels 30 to 40, give or take. Not exactly backwater, but not enough to ensure a steady flow of visitors. This particular location was controlled by an equally mediocre clan that went by the rather ambitious appellation of the Warriors of Light. We'd already looked them up. Apparently, the clan's strongest player was a certain Leslie, a level 200 Alvin archeress. From what Rorgus had told me earlier, their clan was some sort of family outfit. They kept their town nice and neat, never got involved in any major scandals. Basically, they were making an honest buck without stepping on anyone's toes. Interestingly, they'd refused to meet me until Game Forums had finally reported me striking a peace agreement with Tanor.
Tea or coffee?
The nomess asked as we entered a spacious and rather cozily furnished hall.
Or do you prefer something stronger?
Coffee would be nice, thank you. Black, no sugar. She gave me a wink.
One moment.
She walked over to an opposite door and barked,
Hey, kitchen! Whoever you are, two solos!
A muffled grumbling came from behind the thick walls, apparently confirming the order.
Grab a seat, Olgerd.
She pointed at a massive leather armchair, then slumped into an identical one opposite me.
It'll do you good to take the load off your feet.
While I made myself comfortable, surreptitiously studying the house's typically gnomish decor, Lara was watching my every movement. I could see she'd appreciated my gear. Judging by her fiery gaze, my 300-plus purple duds seemed to have impressed her quite a bit. Having finished playing the staring game, she finally got down to business.
Come on, show me this bazooka of yours.
Smiling in anticipation of the seasoned bladesmith's reaction to my humble weapon, I offered her my minor pocket catapult. Her reaction didn't disappoint. She laughed so hard that I was afraid she might have a stroke.
Oh, no! You don't mean it! A minor pocket catapult!
She kept exclaiming in stitches, clutching at her stomach. I shrugged her sarcasm off. Exactly. Now imagine what it felt like when I just logged in for the first time. Lara shook her head in disbelief.
No way!
A young gnome who'd just arrived from the kitchen carrying a drink tray cast uncomprehending glances at her. A few more bearded faces hovered in the kitchen doorway, looking equally bemused, as Lara's bout of laughter must have sped up the preparation of our drinks. Finally, after a few more minutes, Lara had quietened down enough to drink her coffee in silence, wiping an occasional tear of laughter with a white handkerchief, all the while mumbling something about the great conqueror of no man's lands and his minor pocket catapult. I had a smile in my beard, as both of us knew, my catapult wasn't my only secret weapon.
I'm so sorry, Lara said with a guilty smile. I just can't help imagining your face when they'd handed you this Wonder Waffle.
I nodded.
But at the same time, I can't but think what you must have been through. The sheer thought gives me goosebumps. You know, don't you, that you've become a role model for many of our clan members? No amount of hardships and clan hostilities could break you.
Don't flatter me, I said, waving her words away. There's loads of people here whose problems are much worse than mine, and they didn't buckle under pressure either. Even you, the way you're talking about it, one would think that the worst is already over.
But it is, isn't it?
She said, faking surprise. I chuckled. I wish.
Never mind,
Lara said, slapping the chair's leather armrests with her shovel hands.
Let's cut to the chase. I'd better tell you about your weapon's potential upgrades.
It took her 5 minutes to make it clear she could modify my catapult in like 15 different ways. That's a master for you, I thought with a mental whistle of amazement. If she were to be believed, once she had her way with my weapon, you'd be hard-pressed to call it a catapult anymore.
It will be upgraded to blue from its current green,
she said. In theory, my level of mastery is enough to paint it purple, but unfortunately, we're short of certain stones at the moment, she added grimly. It's a rare resource. Our clan, let's face it, isn't yet up to farming these kinds of things.
And what kind of bonus can one expect from it? I asked.
You talking about purple? A lot, like 20% all stats, provided it's already blue.
Oh, really? Not bad. Not bad at all, come to think about it. I'd long written off the catapult as a weapon, putting all my faith in my little menagerie. But if this was how it was, who was I to say no to an extra bonus?
Take your catapult, for instance, Lara went on. Upgrading it to purple would require a certain number of recipes and blueprints. You know it yourself, don't you? Plus, logically, you need someone capable of creating said recipes.
I nodded.
Plus, she went on, I can't create all 15 modifications on my own. I'll need help from a jeweler and a tanner, both of whom will have to be masters, of course.
Seeing me open my mouth, she raised a reassuring hand.
That's not a problem. I've got both of them here, working in our cellar. We've got some sort of production line here.
Great. Admittedly, I have no time to walk around looking for the right kind of master.
That's not a problem at all.
Lara waved my words away.
It's the stones which are the problem, and the one who farms them must be a master too, she added darkly. And just as a cherry on the cake, all the locations containing these kinds of resources have already been claimed by the stronger clans.
I looked at her saddened face. She hadn't told me anything I hadn't already known. This shortage of top-level resources was what had hindered the development of the majority of the Glasshouse clans, which now played right into my hands. Plus, I knew that what I was about to do now was going to dramatically change the future of her clan. This decision hadn't been spontaneous. Rorgus and I had sifted through enormous amounts of information on each and every one of the Glasshouse clans before making contact with one of the groups of light. For a while, we'd been toying with the idea of offering our collaboration to one of the larger clans, but we soon had to abandon the thought. It would be a bit like letting a seasoned fox into a chicken shed. They would quickly begin to dictate their own rules to us and would eventually eat us up hook, line, and sinker. Naturally, this wasn't the kind of scenario we were looking for, even though the temptation of approaching the dead clan was quite strong. Rorgus was already working hand in glove with some of their members, but if we started having problems with the Alliance of Light, and there was not much chance that we wouldn't, I doubted very much that the dead clan would take our side. Which was a shame, really. This was one of the most promising clans which had soared up to top 20, a good ally to keep up one's sleeve. So after many a heated discussion which involved all of my family and brothers in arms, we had finally reached a common denominator. We would seek allies among our peers. All this had flashed through my head before I switched my attention to Lara's disappointed face. Very well, time to take a first step toward our future cooperation. Let's see what these warriors of light were made of. After all, this was the clan we'd picked after much deliberation. They seemed to be a perfect fit, a family business which did its own little thing without antagonizing anyone, but which weren't a bunch of wusses either. It was run by grown-ups, too. Most importantly, the warriors of light were one of the oldest clans in Mirror World, which meant that they preferred to keep a low profile, playing their own little game. So let's see what they were made of. It was my turn to surprise them. Did you say 30% to all stats? I asked, reaching into a little pocket on my belt.
Yes,
she nodded slowly, eyeing my hand with suspicion. Then you'd better take your pick, I said, producing three purple stones and slowly laying them out onto the coffee tray next to the cups. Chapter 2. As I produced more stones, one after the other, the eyes of the Nomes, unreadable so far, were rapidly gaining the likeness to coffee saucers. The sight of the last few especially rendered her speechless.
This is... but how? Why?
She muttered, the rapid change of emotion in her eyes betraying surprise and amazement, replaced by the mix of apprehension and refusal to believe. She gulped, then asked hoarsely,
Who sold them to you? Or is it?
It is, I replied calmly, revealing some of my profession stats to her. Her jaw dropped slowly, adding to the sight of her already boggling eyes.
An expert,
she finally managed. While I'd gone out on recon in no man's lands, I'd found quite a few caves packed with rare resources. I couldn't just ignore such generous gifts. If the truth were known, I already had quite a few purple resources, which Rorgus was going to sell gradually within our close circle of friends to make sure we didn't crash the market. Plus, we'd also set a certain number of them aside exactly for such an occasion, both for personal use and to strike up a good entente with potential allies. Finally, Lara had managed to peel her jaw off the floor.
Listen, Olgerd, let me be honest with you. We did suspect you were a toughie, but not to this extent, no.
I gave a mental chuckle. Funny, really. All those epic battles starring my beasties, which had amassed hundreds of thousands of views on social media, had failed to impress her as much as my profession stats, which meant that Lara and her Warriors of Light were more interested in the practical side of things, not in all those fancy magic-powered battles. I cracked a modest smile.
Who would have thought?
The Nomess repeated without taking her dumbfounded stare off me.
An expert mind digger in my own house! Oh, wish they could see you now. Guys like you are every clan's prized possessions.
You sure I won't regret sharing my secret with you? I'd hate to make this public. Lara threw her hands up in protest.
Olgerd, who do you think I am? I'll be as silent as the grave.
So what about my catapult? I nodded at the stones, trying to steer the conversation back onto its original course. Is this something you could use? The gnomess theatrically slapped her forehead.
I'm such a ditz today,
she announced with a broad grin.
It's not every day that a legendary player and an expert mind digger turns up on your doorstep and armed with a catapult of all things.
I chuckled. You could say that, and you haven't even seen my beasties yet.
Jeez, I don't think my humble abode would survive a visit from your menagerie.
Probably not. My scarab alone was quite capable of reducing her house to rubble in minutes.
Now, talking about stones,
Lara switched to a more businesslike tone.
Let's do it one thing at a time.
Her podgy finger pointed at an elongated dark purple crystal, which I laid down first.
This is Deep Earth Quartzite. It's mega hard. We'll use 5 of these to up your strength and protection. The one in the middle is Moon Kunzite. If we take 7 of those and pulverize them, we'll be able to improve both your accuracy and concentration. And this last one is a Twilight Sugalite. We'll only need 3 of those, but they'll give you a nice big fat bonus to health. That's 15 stones in total, but that's enough for 23 modifications, not 15. I guarantee you won't recognize your old catapult.
Having blurted all this out almost in a single breath, Lara paused, looking me hopefully in the eye. Excellent, I replied, laying out 12 more stones, to Lara's breath of relief. Now we've only to decide on the price and the time frame. Before she could reply, the kitchen door opened, letting in a procession of 3 gnomes, the clan leaders all present and correct. One of them a baldy, another gray-haired, the third one a carrot top. All of them grinders, their stats concealed. Actually, I'd kept some of my own stats open just so they could appreciate my humble achievements. Once everyone was seated, I realized I'd made the right choice. All of them stared in befuddlement at my gear, my levels, and the stones laid out on the tray. The silent staring game was interrupted by the gray-haired gnome called Averon.
We're very pleased to finally meet you in person, Sir Olgerd. Admittedly, we've been following your progress for quite a while, and we're not disappointed by the choices you've made. I'll tell you more. Had you made different decisions in certain situations, we might have never met at all. The maximum you could have counted on then would have been hiring our masters and their services.
He can't but have noticed the faint, skeptical smile that had crossed my lips, so he hurried to smooth out his faux pas. Lara's grim face, too, betrayed acute disapproval of the way her clan leader had approached the matter.
By the same token, the gnome went on, we do understand, especially in view of these highly valuable resources that you've brought here, that you could have easily acquired any such services at any other place, in which case our own masters would have been stripped of this invaluable experience.
Much better. That's how you should have started, mister. The Carrot Top, whose name was apparently Daryl, must have also sensed the strain created by his fellow clan leader.
As regards to the above,
he hurried to butt in,
we suggest that we upgrade your weapon free of charge.
You'll only have to pay for the consumables,
the bald-headed Karam hurried to add. This one didn't give a damn about diplomacy, not where profits were concerned. It still worked out well. Rorgus and I hadn't counted on such an outcome. Still, judging by this show of generosity, the leadership of the Warriors of Light was interested in our cooperation even more than we were. The funny glances that Lara kept casting in their direction were proof enough. I could bet all you want, things hadn't gone according to their initial plan. It looked like the little demonstration of my abilities had disturbed the still waters of their existence. Hard as they tried to control themselves, they couldn't keep their excitement in check. Oh, right. Let's not disappoint their expectations.
Very well, I said, nodding my agreement. I accept your proposal.
The faces around me beamed. Lara appeared the happiest of all, grinning from ear to ear, her steely smile glinting in the sun rays peeking through the window.
In which case, we shouldn't make our master wait, the gray-haired Averon said. Let her go and do the work while we can sit and talk.
Oh, by the way, I suddenly remembered. There's one other thing I have. Take a look. I reached into my inventory for the red buckle I discovered in the nest of rocks and handed it to Lara. I'd love to have a belt made for it. She studied the buckle and announced, her voice ringing with hope and excitement.
If you have two more stones of each kind, the resulting belt would be purple, but the buckle itself will remain red.
Seeing me trying to say something, she hurried to add,
Unfortunately, there's no way we can make it completely red. For that, we would need red stones and experts with levels to match.
I see.
I sighed, unable to conceal my disappointment.
If our earlier conditions suit you, we could have the belt made using the same scheme.
The voice of the bald-headed Karam disturbed me from my ruminations.
We'll only need the stones.
Oh, yes, yes, of course. Here you are, I replied, adding six more purple crystals to the tray under Lara's flabbergasted stare. The casual ease with which I kept producing such rare resources from my inventory must have finally had its effect on them. The three gnomes looked confused, to say the least. Lara was beaming like a full moon polished to perfection. Something was telling me that both she and her clan's leaders were looking at nice little bonuses to their professions before the day was over. Would you like to have the following items upgraded? The Buckle of the Wings of Death Combat Belt, 1. Minor Pocket Catapult, 1. Yes, no. Having accepted, I activated the following transaction. Would you like to hand over the following items? Deep Earth Quartzite, 7. Moon Kunzite, 9. Twilight Sugalite, 5. Yes, no.
Oh, yes. My heart filled with a nostalgic longing as I handed her the catapult. We'd been through a lot together. With a cheerful wink, Lara left the room. Well, let's see what she can do.
Having watched her leave the room, I switched my gaze to the gnome still sitting around.
So, gentlemen, if I understand it correctly, you've got something to discuss with me?
The leaders of the Warriors of Light exchanged stares, as if plucking up courage before one final plunge into the unknown. Each nodded, then, as was rapidly becoming a habit, the gray-haired Averon was the first to speak.
Allow us a little backstory, dear sir. We aren't infringing on your precious time, are we?
In a nutshell, he said the same thing as I, my wife and Rorgus had already discussed at our family meeting. Their clan needed to evolve. If before they could keep a low profile, they wouldn't be able to pull off the same trick anymore. At any given moment, a stronger clan could come to this cute little town and reclaim it. In fact, they were late already, chased at the heel by speedier groups who had no scruples about gaining power. Averon promptly confirmed my suspicions.
We've achieved a lot, you have to agree. Over a dozen expert grinders and a well-equipped combat group of levels 150+ is nothing to sniff at. Unfortunately, that wasn't enough. Mirror World lays down its own law. The clans, which at the time wouldn't have dared look in Rital's direction, are now beginning to show interest in our property. At the moment, we're quite capable of handling them on our own, and we could always sign up some mercs if need be, but it's a lot of money, you know. Besides, in view of the prospects offered by the colonization of no man's lands, the best mercs have already been contracted by the strongest of clans.
All this is highly enlightening, but why are you telling me all this? I asked, giving him a chance to make the first step. Once again, they exchanged stares. The bald-headed Karim was the next to speak. He was even more short-spoken than his cousin.
Because we have seen in you the opportunity that could allow us to evolve.
Keep talking.
I have to be honest with you,
the Keratop Daryl joined in.
Only a few hours ago, our opinion of you was as of someone who'd caught the game's luck by the coattails. But if you'll excuse me, who had little idea of what to do with his good fortune. But this brief demonstration of your abilities, which I suspect are only a fraction of what you can do, has radically changed our opinion of you.
Hiding a triumphant smile in his thick beard, Karim added,
You have your own NPC army, a pocket squad of high-level steel monsters, and the ability to fly to any point in Glasshouse. The powers that be seem to treat you with certain deference, otherwise they wouldn't have struck a truce with you. You have access to rare and valuable resources, and most importantly, you can procure them too. You have no shortage of new instances and high-level mobs. I'd venture a guess that there's at least a couple of top quests involving you. Taking all of the above into consideration, there's one question that begs for attention.
Which is? I asked curiously.
Why us?
Karim blurted. Three pairs of intelligent gnomish eyes focused expectantly on me. I chuckled. They hadn't bought into my little show, which was logical. Never mind. Time to lay some of my cards on the table. My conversation with the gnomes, predictably punctuated with a hearty break for dinner, lasted well into the night. The leaders of the Warriors of Light wanted to know everything. How many NPCs I had under my control, their respective levels, how many of them were civilians and how many actual warriors, whether we'd already begun working on the new settlement, whether we were planning on sending caravans across no man's lands trading with other clans, how aggressive our current location was, and whether we had access to sea. Basically, they tried to squeeze me for every bit of information they could get, and I meted it out, bit by bit, making sure I didn't share any more than suited my purposes. I kept a lot away from them. I hadn't divulged our coordinates, nor the exact number of our warriors, but shared eagerly the peaceful achievements of my Caltean craftsmen. You got the drill. In their turn, the gnomes introduced me to their top fighters who couldn't take their doting eyes off me. I added to the effect by taking them to the backyard, where I showed off Boris and Pranky, who predictably became a sensation. The entire household, whoever happened to be in, poured outside to watch, presided over by Lara herself and the clan leaders. Averon did warn everyone not to film them, though. No idea whether everyone obeyed him, but all the faces around us were suitably solemn. If I could characterize today's meeting, I would describe it as testing the waters and breaking the barriers. Overall, we parted ways quite happy with each other. A layman might ask, what was the point of it all? The answer was simple. This was long-term thinking, or as Rorgus likes to say, if you have to sell, do your homework. One might think that I could just have easily sold the rare stones at an auction, minding my own business in anticipation of the profits turned. But then again, why do so if you can gain some useful contacts on top of actual dosh? Wasn't it worth a few hours of your time? For an admittedly average but relatively wealthy clan like the Warriors of Light, I could become some sort of springboard to a better future. Basically, we just started growing a new clan, potentially strong and, most importantly, initially friendly to me. And once that done, what prevented us from growing several clans like this one? Several more clans awaited their meeting with me now, each of them similar to the Warriors of Light in more ways than one. As soon as I'd bidden goodbye to the clan leaders, Lara stormed back into the room like a snowstorm. Cheerful sparks glistened in her eyes.
a cunning grin flitted across her face. Her hands appeared to shake slightly. Her strong fingers clenched something which looked like a beetle or a crab the size of a saucer. My first thought, once I'd realized what I was looking at, was that my catapult must have died in the pangs of childbirth, transforming into this arthropodal monster with a minigun on its back. "So," I drawled, studying Lara's creation. A steel bracer which almost completely covered my entire right forearm served as a support for a thing which looked like a fist-sized scorpion. Its tail was a 6-faceted gun barrel, about 2 hands long. Its muzzle was about 1/2 inch wide. The entire weapon was covered in angular, gnomish writings. What about its stats, then? Name, a magic arbalest. Category, epic. Weapon type, main, non-transferable. Weapon class, automatic, 15-chambered. Reload rate, 15 seconds. Level, over 150. Restriction, only Ennin race. Range, plus 100. Accuracy, plus 135. Protection, plus 150. Strength, plus 125. Concentration, plus 75. Stamina, plus 150. Damage, plus 550, plus 650. Durability, unbreakable.
So? Lara demanded impatiently, anxiously watching my reaction. You're full of surprises, you. I cracked a happy smile. But what about the ammo? I have a funny feeling that pebbles won't cut it anymore.
Ha 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 ha! She chuckled victoriously. Don't worry yourself about that. As soon as I'd finished modifying your pea shooter, the system offered me 3 new ammo blueprints, each of them epic. Here, take a look.
She poured 3 cone-shaped bullets into my open hand, each as long as my pinky. They were enveloped in a faint purple haze, a standard visual effect for epic items. Oh well, let's see. The one on the right was the biggest. It was also the darkest of the 3, almost black, its surface streaked with complex runic writings. I switched the other 2 to my left hand, then flipped the bulky bullet a few times in my right hand. Heavy, I commented.
Yep,
Lara agreed.
Now go look at its stats.
Okay. Name, Crusher, armor-piercing bullet. Category, epic. Weapon type, ammunition. Level, over 150. Restriction, only Ennin race. Cooldown, 10 seconds. Damage, plus 500. Special effects. Additional damage to all physical shields, plus 5%. Additional damage to all magic shields, plus 3%. Durability, single use.
So, I managed. Talk about pebbles.
Lara chuckled.
Nice, eh? The damage in itself is nothing to sniff at, but think of all the energy shields these thingies are going to gobble up.
Actually, where did you get the resources to make them? I asked in surprise. I didn't have any extra stones to give you, did I?
Production bonuses, she replied. Sometimes we do get double whammies for the amount of resources spent. You keep working on an item and then bang, you get twice the result, just like our jeweler had with your stones. There are certain caveats, though. The rarity of the recipe or blueprint play a part, as well as that of the resource itself, as does the frequency of the item's production. We've already noticed that normally all such double whammies happen when you're just starting out on a new profession level. Basically, they encourage you on your way to the next objective. Hasn't it ever happened to you?
I shook my head. Not that I know of.
It will,
she reassured me.
It always does.
I doubted it. Still, it was nice of her. So, how many of those double whammies did it take? I asked, with a cunning smile.
Now this, mister, is very bad form,
she replied, mirroring my grin with her own.
Seriously, let me give you some free advice. No master worth their salt would appreciate this kind of question.
Okay, okay, I threw my hands in the air. I'm sorry, she chuckled.
You must have forgotten how to keep good company in those no man's lands of yours. Never mind, keep looking.
Her finger pointed at another cone-shaped bullet. This one appeared to be cast of indigo ice, with the same runic writings encircling its surface.
Cold, eh?
she asked, seeing me focus on my sensations. I nodded as I proceeded to study its stats. Name: Ice Thorn, Charmed Bullet. Category: Epic. Weapon type: Ammunition. Level: Over 150. Restriction: Only Enin Race. Cooldown: 7 seconds. Damage: Plus 100. Special effects: Slows the enemy's speed 100%. Duration: 3 seconds. Durability: Single use. And finally, the last one. This one was a murky purple color and felt sticky to the touch. Name: Fang of a Spotted Adder. Charmed Bullet. Category: Epic. Weapon type: Ammunition. Level: Over 150. Restriction: Only Enin Race. Cooldown: 8 seconds. Damage: Plus 100. Special effects: Poisons the enemy with the venom of a spotted adder. Duration: 3 seconds. Damage: 350 points life per second. Durability: Single use. I stopped reading and looked up at Lara. She watched my reaction in silence, folding her arms across her chest. Judging by her pleased expression, she was happy with the effect. Very well, I could please her even further. In one smooth motion, I produced another handful of purple stones and said with a smile, "Think you could make me some more?" Chapter 3. Boris habitually took to the sky. In the glow of the giant moon, his plumage glinted silver. Every one of his colossal wing beats brought us closer to the borders of no man's lands. How long had I been gone? Just over a month? Well, it felt like a couple of years, even though my offline break had flashed past like a single day in the company of my dear girls. Now I was alone again. The familiar crimson alert popped up before my eyes, wrenching me out of my reverie and warning me of crossing into no man's lands. I checked the map. I was curious how the Twilight Castle was advancing in control of the Alliance of Light. Or was it already in the hands of the Dark Clans? Would the castle's new owners be able to get along with the crazy ghost? Judging by the absence of news, the obelisk hadn't been activated yet. What were they waiting for? Enin City was about 40 minutes away as the crow flies. Boris growled contentedly as if reading my thoughts. A level 300-plus mount is nothing to sniff at. I smiled as I gave him a pat on his broad, armored back. Good boy! The next few minutes, I was busy patting and rubbing my armored birdie. I'd missed him so much. Finally, I stopped all the caressing nonsense. Time to take a better look at my new gadget, or should I say my rejuvenated gadget. Whatever, let's do it. The scorpion-like weapon clinging to my right forearm looked unusual. Having said that, who was I to complain? This was definitely an improvement on my old catapult. I shook my arm, moving it around. It felt okay, quite snug in fact. I felt no discomfort. My new toy was virtually weightless. I tried to mentally move the arbalest to my pocket, then retrieve it. It worked. What was even better, it didn't invoke the usually inevitable confirmation message. Easy. I stretched my right arm out in front of me, trying to take aim. Immediately, a round panel appeared before my eyes, the virtual sights, complete with crosshairs. As soon as I lowered my arm, the panel disappeared too. How cool was that? Why hadn't Lara told me about it? Then again, how was she supposed to know? This was a non-transferable weapon, tailor-made for me alone. I reached out again, taking aim at the snowy peak of a gray mountain looming on the horizon. The sights came to life, slightly zooming in on the summit. A new message appeared under the crosshairs. Range to target, unknown. Warning. Maximum range, 300 feet. You couldn't argue with that. Stats were stats. Still, the very existence of these sights suggested the future possibility of an even more advanced upgrade, which was very good news. I moved my arm around in search for a more suitable target, but predictably found none, with the exception of clouds overhead, which the system just refused to highlight as potential extermination material. Never mind, I could always practice later. There'd be plenty of targets once I was back on terra firma. Let's take a look at the bullets then. Apart from the three top-level types already mentioned, I'd also ask Lara to crank out 400 regular ones for me. Name, regular bullet. Category, rare. Weapon type, ammunition. Level, over 150. Restriction, only Enin race. Cooldown, 1 second. Damage, plus 70. Durability, single use. Lara warned me not to do anything stupid, especially not to try and draw any runes on them. All these bullets were single use, so any attempt to modify them would simply result in destroying them. Shame. Now, what next? Judging by the arbalest's own description, it could accommodate 15 projectiles. Then, once the entire clip was spent, it was followed by a 15-second cooldown, which was normal, really. After that, you could throw yourself back into the fight. Okay, that much was clear. Let's load the clip then. Warning, we've discovered 4 types of projectiles suitable for your magic arbalest. Would you like to load it with the bullets of one type? Or would you like to create a particular sequence of projectiles of different types? A sequence? Oh, let's have a think. It would probably be most logical to start with an ice bullet, which would slow my enemy down 100%. It had a cooldown of 7 seconds. I could follow it up with a crusher, which had a cooldown of 10 seconds, followed by number 3, a venomous debuff with an 8-second cooldown. By then, the slow effect of the first one would expire. I added 4 regular bullets, 7 seconds in total, followed by another ice thorn, plus 2 more regular ones. Shot number 11 would be another fang of a spotted adder, followed by another crusher and 2 more regular ones. Finally, to complete the sequence, I entered another ice thorn, which would slow the enemy down for 3 more seconds, followed by a 15-second cooldown, after which my weapon would be ready for another clip. Would you like to save the existing sequence? Yes, no. Oh, yes, please. I built a few more clips, just in case, and made a few more bullets of each type. Good, clear enough. Now, how about firing single rounds? Apparently, the devs just couldn't be bothered to come up with something original, but simply copied the spell interface similar to the one used by mages. 4 new icons appeared under the crosshairs depicting my new projectiles. The pale blue one stood for Ice Thorn, the dark purple depicted the Crusher, the acid green stood for the Fang of the Spotted Adder, and the gray one meant regular bullets. The highlighted digits in the corner of each icon signified the number of projectiles available. I practiced switching between them. It worked. It did take some kind of knack, but with time, I was pretty sure I'd get used to it. That was all as far as the arbalest and its settings were concerned. All the finer pros and cons I would have to learn from practice. And practice, as my daughter Krista would have said, was major key in my situation. Now the belt. Name, the Wings of Death Combat Belt. Category, legendary. Type, armor. Level, over 50. Restriction, only Enin race. Effect, plus 170 points strength. Effect, plus 10 points protection. Effect, plus 270 points stamina. Effect, plus 170 points vigor. Warning, the item is non-transferable. What a strange collection of effects. Funny what the purple belt leather could do in combination with the red buckle. Still, the system had recognized the item as part of a legendary set of armor. Its stats had also grown, which was nothing to sniff at. According to Lara, the belt was still modifiable, provided it was done by an expert-level tanner and bladesmith, respectively. Plus, it would require some resources to match. In other words, a fully red belt might take some patience. Not that it mattered. The most important thing was, I was wearing it already, buckle and all. I've been getting pretty fed up with the buckle being a waste of space in my inventory, its awesome stats staring me in the face all this time. Warning, you're approaching the vicinity of Twilight Castle. We've arrived, kiddo, I whispered in Boris's ear. Now you can start dropping altitude. No need to fuss. There's absolutely no rush. That's because I had no idea who might be gallivanting about below. Landing right on top of some sharpshooter dude was the last thing we needed. Obeying the order, Boris dove into the thick cloud layer. After a few more moments, we were already soaring over the mountain which once used to house the Enin's Forbidden City. The view below sent shivers up my spine. What the hell had happened here? The entire valley by the foothill now resembled a giant battlefield. I got the impression that it had been blanket-bombed with every weapon under the sun. It was pockmarked with shell holes and bore evidence of some serious magic damage. Heaps of vitrified rock were still smoking in places, some of the craters filled with black goo, which looked very, very toxic. Oh, had my squad arrived here now, doubtful we'd be able to even approach the city. Wherever you turned, you'd be obliged to walk into some nasty surprise. Whatever you say, leaving this place, well alone, had been the right decision. Oh yes, all of the Noctean hordes were nothing compared to what the players' clans had done to this place. The thought made my blood run cold. Sooner or later, they were obliged to reach the Silver Mountains. It was time I took care of Calteian defenses. Human players seemed to be progressing at a rate of knots. As we were wheeling over the ruins of the city, which now looked more like a chunk of Swiss cheese, I tried hard to make out what was left of our fortifications, as if everything around us had changed beyond recognition. Strangely enough, I was yet to see a single player. Could they all be hiding underground? I had no desire to find out. Still, I was yet to receive the answer to my main question. Why hadn't they activated the Twilight Obelisk yet? Were they short of energy to do so? Nonsense. For a group of clans, raising even a million points of energy wouldn't have been a problem. Some sort of system restrictions, maybe. Doubtful. The devs had made it clear I wasn't the guardian of this place any longer. They were bound to have left some kind of loophole to circumvent racial restrictions. What could it be, then? It was on the tip of my tongue, but still, I couldn't quite pinpoint it. Never mind. Plenty of time to think about it. It's all right, kiddo. Let's go home. I sensed something was wrong just as I approached the Silver Mountain Valley, the Calteans' new home. Just like the area around Twilight Castle earlier, the place was completely deserted, not a single soul around.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.